I loved your YouTube channel. I thought it was really, really creative. And I don't
Yeah. Yeah. How about you go ahead and introduce yourself?
Hey, how you doing? I'm Gary K. Wolf. I'm the creator of Roger Rabbit. I'm a writer. I do books and also movies. And I'm speaking here today with two fine young gentlemen who are going to leave me shaking in my boots from the depth of their perceptive questions.
First question is like an obvious one. How did it feel having your novel like be adapted into a Hollywood movie?
I wrote that novel when I was living in San Francisco. It was my fourth novel, and I wanted to do something that incorporated the loves of my life, which were comic books, cartoons, comic strips, and noir mysteries, hard-boiled private eye mysteries. I had a contract with Doubleday for four novels, and I had written three of those novels. The first one was Killer Bowl, the second one was A Generation Removed, the third one was The Resurrectionist, and they were science fiction novels. I wanted to do something that incorporated the loves of my youth, so I was looking around for a premise that I could use to hang that on. I mean, incorporating private eyes and cartoon characters is not easy. So I was watching Saturday morning cartoons one Saturday morning, just purely for research. I told my wife, just research. I'm not enjoying this. This is just research. And I was taken not with the cartoons themselves, which were pretty simplistic and pretty crude, but with the commercials, because the commercials showed real kids talking to cartoon characters, and nobody seemed to think that was odd. There was Cap'n Crunch and Snap, Crackle, and Pop, and the Trix Rabbit and Tony the Tiger, and cartoon characters and real kids. And I thought, geez, what a great idea that would be for a book. What kind of world would that be if you had a world where cartoon characters were real? So I wrote the book. I researched comic books, cartoons, and comic strips to see what kinds of things would happen there that would really be fun in a human world. And I came up with word balloons, which they use in comic strips and comic books. And so the tunes in my book don't speak; they talk in word balloons. So you don't listen to them; you actually have to read them. And if the cartoon character, if the tune turns around, you got to turn around with him and look at him from the other side, or you got to learn to read backwards because his word balloon spins around too. And it produces a bang balloon, and the bang balloon kind of hangs off and falls to the ground, and they're very brittle. If they don't break, you can pick it up and preserve it, and then if you find the gun you think committed the crime, you produce another bang balloon, and if the two bang balloons match, that's the gun. People, when they play the piano, the notes go trailing off, and people take those strings of notes and cut them into 8x12 sheets, and that's where sheet music comes from. So I had a lot of fun with that, and it took me a year to write the book. I sent it to Doubleday. It was the fourth novel in my four novel contract. And I never had a reject. I mean, I'd written 100 short stories and three novels, never had a reject. But they rejected that book, which was Who Censored Roger Rabbit? And so I called my editor and I said, Sharon, why did you reject this book? And it's clearly the best thing I've ever written. And she says, oh, I agree. She said, it was funny. It was witty and innovative, but it was so different from anything you've written before. So different from anything anybody's written before, that I had to send it to the marketing department and get their approval. So I called the head of marketing and I said, Chuck, why did you reject my novel? He says, oh, we love that novel. Everybody here in marketing love that novel, but It's like nothing that's ever been written before. There's no category for it on the bookstore shelves. It's not a regular adult novel. It's not a kid's novel. It's not science fiction. It's not fantasy. It's not really a mystery. He says, there's no category for it on the bookstore shelves. He says, I can't sell this novel. And so I said to him, you know, what would you do if somebody today gave you The Wizard of Oz or Gulliver's Travels or Alice in Wonderland? What would you do with those? And he thought for a minute. He says, I couldn't sell those either. I said, well, okay. So I called my agent, and I said, Bill, I said, I don't know. I don't know what to do here, because if I can't publish this novel, I don't want to be a writer anymore, because this is what I want to write. And he says, oh, don't worry about it. He says, we'll find a home for it. So he started sending it out to other publishing companies, other agents, other editors. And along the way, it racked up 110 rejects. 110 different publishers rejected Who Censored Roger Rabbit, and always for the same reason. There's no category for this on the bookstore shelves. We can't sell it. My wife used to, in those days, I guess today I don't get many rejects, but I guess today you probably get them by email, but in those days you got them by, they came as a letter. And my wife used to call my trip out to the mailbox every day the daily disappointments, because I'd go out to the mailbox and come back with like a fistful of rejects. And finally, the 111th submission, it got to a woman named Rebecca St. Martin, Rebecca Martin at St. Martin's Press. And she had just published a big major bestseller for them. And so they gave her a vanity project. They said, look, you can publish any book you want, whatever you want, you can publish. And Roger Rabbit came across her desk, and she said, oh, this is it. So she took that to the president of the company and said, here's the book I want to publish. And he said, all right, I'm going to take it home. I'm going to read it tonight. I'll get back to you in the morning. So he took it home, came back the next day, called her in the office. He says, Rebecca, said, I told you could publish anything you want, but you can't publish this because I can't sell it. And Rebecca stood up to the plate and said, look, you told me I could publish it, either publish it or I quit. So they published it, and in very small quantities, 5,000 copies, which in the book world is like next to nothing. The people tell me, people ask me, if you could go back in time and change something in your life, do something differently, what would you change? And what I would do is I would go back in time to 1981 when that book came out, and I would buy all 5,000 copies because they sold for $2.99, $2.99. And now, if you can find one on eBay for under $500, it's a deal. So I would have bought them all, put them in a barn somewhere, and I'd be selling them off today, and I'd be living in a castle in Spain and wouldn't be talking to you guys, but so they agreed to bring it out, and it hadn't come out yet. It took about a year between the time they bought and the time it came out. It took about a year, and I was at home, and my phone rang, and I answered. And they says, is this Gary K. Wolf? I said, yes, it is. He says, well, hi, this is Roy Disney with the Disney Company.
Wow.
Yeah, right. Roy
That's
Disney calling me at home.
fun.
That's like, that's gonna happen. And he says, yeah, come on, who is this really? He says, no, it's really Roy Disney. And I read your book. I said, ah, come on, get out of town. It didn't even come out yet. And it turned out that somebody at St. Martin's had sent a copy of the manuscript to the Disney Company. And they said, we think you might like this. We think you might enjoy this, and it might be good for you for a movie. And they did like it. They liked it very much, because at the time, Disney was not the Disney that they are today. They were making movies about the Nutty Professor and Flubber and the black hole and the black cauldron, which disappeared down the black hole. They were making movies for the second half of double features, and you guys probably don't even know what a double feature is, because they don't have them anymore. They used to have two movies on a bill, and now they don't have that anymore. And Disney was in danger of becoming a second-rate movie production house, or maybe even going out of business. So they needed something that would kind of leapfrog them back into prominence, and they saw this as being that project. Plus, they had another ulterior motive. You've probably noticed that you can't go anywhere without seeing somebody wearing a cap or a sweatshirt or a jacket or something with a Disney character on it. I mean, Disney makes a ton of money selling merchandise, and they wanted the characters. They wanted Roger, Baby Herman, Jessica, for their merchandise. They offered me more money for the rights to it than I'd made on everything I'd written up to that time put together. So I said, sure, go ahead. And you've read the book, right? Well,
I'm about like halfway through it.
you started it, so
Yeah.
it's not like the movie.
Okay, no.
The book is the best possible book I knew how to write. And it forces a reader to use his or her imagination. The movie just lays it right out there. No imagination required. It's all right there on the screen. I really didn't think that this was a filmable book. I didn't see how they were going to make a movie out of this book and stay true to my premise. And for the first couple of years, they proved me right. They really couldn't pull it together. They tried all different kinds of things. And admittedly, the technology that they needed in 1980, 81, 82, 83, 84, the technology that they needed didn't exist. So they really had trouble doing it. At one point, Roy Disney came to me and said, Gary, we're having trouble doing this in live action animation. What would you think if we did it with all the cartoon characters wearing costumes like they do at Disneyland? And I thought, oh, geez, doesn't that compromise the principle just a little bit? And they, yeah, okay, I guess. So they went off, and I don't know. They probably never would have gotten. Well, maybe they would have. I don't know. But they weren't having any luck. And then in 1985, Roy Disney got forced out and got replaced by a guy named Michael Eisner. Mike Eisner brought came over from Paramount and brought with him a guy named Jeffrey Katzenberg. And the two of them together had done old Jaws and E.T. and a whole bunch of movies.
Right,
And
and Jeffrey Katzenberg went on to found DreamWorks.
DreamWorks SKG with his buddy Steve Spielberg, yeah, and Geffen, yes. And so when those two came in, they threw out every project that Disney had in development except for Roger Rabbit, which they realized they had to make. They had to make this movie. So they did something that nobody at Disney had ever done before. They brought in an outside producer to produce the movie. And that was a little known guy named Steve Spielberg, right? So Steve Spielberg comes in, and the minute Steve Spielberg gets involved in your project, things start to happen. As an example, in 1983, Roy Disney went to Warner Brothers and said, "Hey, look, we're doing this live action animation movie over Disney. We'd like to have Bugs Bunny come on screen for 10 seconds and say, 'What's up, Doc?' Just to make a cameo." And Warner Brothers looked at Roy Disney and said, "Get lost. Get lost. There's no way that Bugs Bunny is ever going to be in a Walt Disney picture. That's just never going to happen." So 3 years later, Steve Spielberg walks in and makes the identical request. Can we have Bugs Bunny for a cameo?" And Warner Brothers looks at Steve Spielberg and says, of course, Bugs, yeah, sure. What about the Roadrunner and Wile E. Coyote and Porky Pig and Tweety Bird and Sylvester and Yosemite Sam? Take them all. Take them all." And so Steve walked out with all of them. And the only requirement was that Bugs Bunny, being a superstar, had a contract. His contract stated that Bugs had to be in every scene with Mickey Mouse because they were co-equal superstars. You could not have a scene with only Mickey. Bugs had to be there too. And they had to have the exact same number of words of dialogue. So the next time you watch the movie, you can time it and you can count the words and you'll see they both have the same words. So, basically the movie was rolling, got made and came out. It was the most profitable and best reviewed movie of 1988. And suddenly, instead of being just some hack science fiction writer, I was the guy who created Roger Rabbit. And I mean, that is something that will be with me forever. After I'm long gone, I mean, on my tombstone, it will read Gary K. Wolfe, he created Toontown and Roger Rabbit. And in my wildest dreams, when I was writing this book, sitting at my kitchen table at 4 in the morning before I went to work, in my wildest dreams, I never dreamt that especially Roger and especially Jessica would become cultural icons. And I mean, those are my characters. So it's just astounding to me and incredibly gratifying.
Is it still like, I mean, like obviously it's been a long time since the movie's come out. It's still.
30, about 30, let's see, it was 1988, so 35 years, yeah.
So it's still like just, like you said, gratifying. It's still
Oh,
like.
absolutely, sure, absolutely. You guys will understand, you guys will appreciate this. Every week, I get probably 30 pictures of young cosplayers, young women cosplayers, and some men too, which I don't mind, of young women cosplayers sending me pictures of themselves dressed as Jessica Rabbit. All right. And if I had known when I was writing the book that there would come a time when every week 35 beautiful young women would be sending me pictures of themselves wearing a low-cut red dress, I would have written the book a whole lot sooner. So, Roger himself, cultural icon, he was just in the Rescue Rangers movie, and everybody was cheering because wow, Roger Rabbit's back. It's something that will be mine forever and that will stay with me and that I will always appreciate.
Yeah, so I got another question. Was there any specific event or book that like that you read as a child or experience that triggered your love for writing?
Sure. So how I got into writing. I was in the second, maybe third grade, probably, I don't know, one of the two. And our I went to a very small school in a farm town called Earlville, Illinois. And I was in the second or third grade, and our teacher, as an assignment, gave us a picture. And she said, I want you to take this picture home and color it and then bring it back tomorrow. And the whole point of the exercise was to stay inside the lines, right? Stay inside the lines. Well, there was nobody better at staying inside the lines than I was. So I took that picture home that night and I looked at it. And the picture was a typical farm scene. I mean, Earlville was a farm town, and this picture just happened to be a typical farm scene. There was a meadow, there was a fence, there was a farmhouse, there was a barn, and there was one cow out in the middle of the field. So I colored the barn red. Barns were always red. The farmhouses around Earlville were yellow, so I colored the farmhouse yellow. Fence brown, grass green. And I come to the cow. And my mother had always told me that when people were sad and lonely and all by themselves, that they got blue. And I said, well, works for people must work for cows. And so I colored that cow blue. And do you know what blue means in that context? Blue means sad, right? And so I colored that cow blue and passed it in. And so the next day, the day after, teacher handed them all back except for mine. And she says, Gary, she says, you come up here to the front of the class. And I said, oh, wow, I stayed inside the lines better than anybody. And she said, she held this picture up over my head like this, me facing the class. And she said, class, she said, look at this stupid, stupid picture. She said, everybody knows that cows are black, cows are white, cows are brown. Sometimes cows are black, white, and brown, all three. Never, never, ever are cows blue. She says, Gary, don't ever do anything this stupid again. And she called my mom, and my mom had to go to school, which was a big deal for my mom. I mean, the teacher calling her and telling her to come to school. And the teacher said, I think there's something wrong with Gary. He colored a cow blue. Cows aren't blue. So that night, my mother and my dad called me into the living room, and they sat me down. And my mom said to me, she says, Gary, why did you color that cow blue? And I said, Ma, she said, it wasn't me, it was you. You know, you're the one. You said, people are sad and lonely. They get blue. Blue means sad and lonely. And she said, oh, okay. She says, you go outside and play. Dad and I have to talk about this. So you have to realize that my mother and father were children of the Depression. My dad had to drop out of school in the third grade to go to work, and my mom had to drop out of school in the eighth grade to go to work. So these weren't what you would call today well-educated urban liberals. I mean, these were hardscrabble working folks, and I was just a kid. I didn't know how this was going to turn out. But after about half an hour, my mom and dad called me back in, and my mom said to me, she says, Gary, your dad and I talked about this, and we decided that the next time you want to color a cow blue, you go ahead and color a cow blue. And she called my teacher. She says, next time he wants to color a cow blue, go ahead and let him. Go ahead and let him. And that was kind of like the first time anybody ever validated my creativity and said, the kinds of weird things that you're thinking about and writing about are fine. Go ahead and do it. So a couple of weeks later, that same teacher gave us another assignment. We had to write what we did on our summer vacation, and the kids were writing about how they went up to Chicago or went to the Wisconsin Dells or whatever. And I wrote about how I went out in the backyard and I used tin foil and tin cans and some string and built a rocket ship and flew to the moon. And she just passed it back on my desk and said, well, that must have been quite a trip. So and that's really how it started. My mom was a good mom. That's one example. But the other example was she told me, she said, look, if you want to get out of this town, which was 1,400 people total, my dad ran the pool hall there, and my mom worked in the school cafeteria. And then she said, if you want to get out of this town, you don't want to wind up running your dad's pool hall. The one thing you can do to make that happen is to read. Just read, 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 and that will get you out of this town. So I read. I read constantly. I mean, I always had something in my hand to read, always. But good mother that she was, she didn't care what I read as long as I read. So what did I read? I read comic books. I read every comic book I could get my hands on. I'd go down to Giles B. Street smoke shop where they sold them. And I on Tuesday, when the new ones came in, I'd read all I could before he'd throw me out. And then I'd use my allowance to buy more, and then I'd trade them with my friends and read comic books. And the other thing that I read was something that my dad read, which was called True Crime Magazines. And thank goodness they don't have those anymore. Or maybe they do, I don't know. But they were magazines, and they featured stories about true crime. Illustrated with photographs, and these true crimes were all murders. And they were graphic pictures of dead bodies on these magazines. And this was something, I mean, you can go into any drugstore or supermarket and buy these magazines. They were called true crime magazines. And my dad read them, and they were all around the house. So I read them too. And, God love my mom because she never once said, oh, don't read that stuff, it'll rot your brain. So I grew up reading comic books and true crime mysteries. Luckily I graduated to a better class of true crime magazines, noir mysteries, Dashiell Hammett, Mickey Spillane, Ross McDonald. But those were my influences. And I started writing science fiction. Because I got hooked on science fiction very early in the seventh grade, I read my first science fiction novel, which was a book called Space Hawk. And I got hooked on science fiction. So my first couple of books were science fiction, but Roger Rabbit goes all the way back to my mom telling me to read, and me reading comic books and horrible, horrible graphic true mystery magazines.
This is probably my favorite question that I wrote. Is what kind of led you to you kind of display toons as like second class citizens in like the book?
Yes, that's intentional. Yeah,
Right.
I base tunes on every second class citizen, every citizen who's ever been repressed. I see tunes as the blacks, the blacks of the South in the Civil War. I see them as the Jews of Nazi Germany. I see them as the downtrodden people of today, the second class citizens. And I did that intentionally. That's what tunes are. And luckily for me, Spielberg saw that, and so did Bob Zemeckis, the director. And they clearly they pretty clearly put that into the movie. The tunes are second class citizens, and that's exactly the way I intended it to be. There, people are always coming up to me and saying, "Hey, what about this?" And they will throw out something that is a spin on something that I did that has some deep psychological meaning that I wasn't aware of. Now maybe I did it unintentionally, which probably happens. I don't know, but a lot of it I wasn't aware of, and I didn't do. But that I was aware of, and that I did. Yes, and that's good to pick up on.
Yeah, it was a very interesting part of the book and the movie. Another, this is just like a personal question that I kind of want to
Sure.
know. Like, have you ridden the ride at Disneyland, the
Of
ride?
course. Of course. They consulted with me when they built Toontown at Disneyland. And when I walk through it, it's like walking through my own imagination. If you go through Disneyland, you will notice that there are no straight lines. Every line is crooked. And when we built Disneyland, the architects, who were all Imagineers working for Disney, built it with no straight lines. And then the builders came along and said, "We can't build this. There's no straight lines." But they did. And I've ridden the ride many, many times. It's one of my favorite dark rides. There are things at Disneyland that are hidden, like there's a manhole cover. If you stand on the manhole cover and stomp your foot three times, you can hear the weasels underneath plotting to kidnap Jessica. And if you go into the post office, you'll see all of the characters, including Roger, Goofy, Mickey, have mailboxes. And if you know the right code to their mailbox and put in the right code, they'll talk to you. It's just spectacular. One of the deals when I sold the book to Disney, my agent said to me, "This is Disney, and this will probably never be a movie because most of them aren't. So what do you want from Disney that I can ask for instead of money?" And you'll get the money too, but in addition to money. And I said, "Well, I want two lifetime passes to Disneyland." And that turned out to be the hardest point of negotiation, because the accountants there said, "Well, what if he goes every week? I mean, we could wind up losing thousands of dollars here." Well, it turned out that I was in California at the time, and I didn't go at all. And then the movie was getting ready to come out, and I told my wife, I said, "We've got to go, because if this movie is a bomb, they'll shoot me at the gate. So we got to go before the movie opens." And I went, and it was the most joyous time I've ever had in my life. I was just a kid when Disneyland first opened, and I always wanted to go. And it more than lived up to
Yeah.
the hype. I mean, it was just, it's a wonderful place. You'll have a great time.
Are there any specific qualities or personality traits that you wanted to establish for Roger Rabbit when you were creating him?
I wanted Roger to be a Disney version of Bugs Bunny. Bugs Bunny is the kind of cartoon character, he'll pat you on the back and then stick a dynamite down your pants. But Mickey Mouse would never do that. I mean, Mickey Mouse is a kind of a friendly, outgoing, jovial character. And that's what I wanted Roger Rabbit to be. I wanted Roger Rabbit to be fun, funny, kind of sweet, caring, just like a Disney kind of rabbit. And I think I did that. I think his relationship with Jessica, I get all kinds of comments about the fact that he and Jessica are so much in love, and they're married, and it's just a wonderful, wonderful relationship. So I always saw Eddie Valiant and Roger Rabbit as two halves of the same person. You know, Roger is all fun and good times and yucks, and Eddie Valiant is all serious and by the book and hard knuckles, and together the two of them make one good person. So if I had to say, you know, is this autobiographical? I would say yeah, that Roger and Eddie together are me.
It's very interesting.
For anybody who's listening, if you want to know more, go to my website, www.garywolf.com, and you will learn more about me than you ever want to know in your life. Read my books, because everybody should read my books, because they're works of incomparable genius. And I got to tell you guys, you guys are great. You got a great career in broadcast journalism. You know,
Thanks.
as soon as you can get some quarters together and buy a whole hour of Zoom time,
Yeah,
your business is
I'm
really
sorry
going to
about
pay.
that.
So when the movie came out, I premiered at Radio City Music Hall in 1988, and I was you know I was up in the I was up in the VIP balcony with the VIPs, and I had sitting on my left Kathleen Turner, who was the voice of Jessica, who was one of the most beautiful women I'd ever seen in my life, and on my right was Amy Irving, who was Steve Spielberg's wife at the time, and like the second most beautiful woman I'd ever seen in my life. And I'm thinking to myself, you know, here I am sitting between two beautiful women. I'm going to see my movie all the way through for the first time. I'm going to see my credit on screen for the first time. And I'm thinking, you know, life just doesn't get any better than that. And by golly, life got better, because Kathleen reached over and grabbed my leg and whispered in my ear. He says, "Gary, are you excited?" And I said, "Kathleen, you have no idea." So the next day, my wife and I, we, th th this was, of course, in New York City, and my wife and I went over to Macy's because we heard that they had Roger Rabbit merchandise for sale. And I vowed I would buy the first piece of Roger Rabbit merchandise that I ever saw. So we went over to Macy's, and I asked the woman at the information desk on the first floor. I said, "Do you have Roger Rabbit merchandise?" And she said, "Yes, we do." And I said, "Where is it?" She said, "Second floor." I said, "We're on the second floor." She said, "Second floor." So we went up to the second floor, and the entire second floor was Roger Rabbit merchandise. The first piece I bought was a Roger Rabbit lunchbox, because that's the first thing I saw, and I thought I would buy the first piece of merchandise I saw. So Roger Rabbit lunchbox, still have it. It's plastic, has the beverage container in it. But as we're walking up and down the aisles looking at the Roger Rabbit merchandise, I bump into Charlie Fleischer, and Charlie Fleischer is the voice of Roger Rabbit, and I was checking out the merchandise, and he was checking out the merchandise, and so I said, "Charlie," I said, are you getting royalties on this?" He says, "Yeah, the stuff with my voice on it." I said, "Like what?" And he says, "Well, like this doll." And he pulls this doll off the shelf. And I said, "Charlie, I'm going to buy this doll, and will you autograph it for me?" And he says, "Yeah, it'll be the first thing I autograph as the voice of Roger Rabbit." So he autographed it for me, and
That's cool.
drew this picture, and
That's cool.
so there we are. That's my rabbit. I don't know what your rabbit story is.
I got mine on eBay. Yeah.
Hey, this is Gary K. Wolf, creator of Roger Rabbit and Toontown, saying, "Miss Lim's class rocks," and subscribe to Yato Beto.
Right, thank you very much.
Thank you.
My great pleasure, guys. Hey, thanks. I had a good time. All right.
Really nice
That's great.
talking to you.
All right. We'll see you. Take care.